questions, or I can also talk a little bit about my roots. How do you want? Yeah, I come to cinema quite late in a way. I made my first film with 39, which is in the same time a recommendation. It's good if you wait till you make the first long film. I'm coming from literature, many filmmakers. You must know that the film schools come up in the world only after the Second World War, with exception of the Russian film school called VGIK, who was founded in Moscow by Lenin. Very early, in 22, I think, 21 or 22. And the other countries didn't exist, film school, till after the war. So that the half of the history of the cinema, which is now 100 years old, approximately, a half of the history of cinema was made by by people who didn't come from a film school. They come all from, almost all from literature, some of them from theater, and very few from the visual arts, from painting. I started as a writer, very young, with as teenager, with 16, 17, and I wrote prosa as it was at the time, fantastic short stories influenced by the great South American writers like Borges and Cortazar. And then when I was a student on the beginning of my of the studies, I think in the second year or so, it was a kind of context in my hometown in the western of Romania. It's called Timișoara. In my whole time, it was also the biggest pop band of the country called Phoenix, and they had to record a new album, and their text writer had a kind of block. He couldn't write anymore, and one day I was in the cafeteria of the university, and it was like a rumor that the Phoenix are coming. They were also students there, but they never appeared. So I was also not so often in the school. But on that day, I was in the cafeteria, and the leader of the band come to me and asked me, I heard you are one of us. That means I had long hair. And you are writing? I said, yes. I need some text because we are in the crisis of 5 or 6 or so. And the music is already done. And I told him, I'm not a poet. I write prose. I cannot make now rhymes on a already existing metric and so. But I had a good friend, and he is this kind of poet. He can get this. So, and I go to my friend, and I... he's older than me and the other generation. He has nothing to do with pop. He told me, well, and can I understand nothing from this kind of music and in general for your generation with the long hair and so. But if you want, we can do it together. You say me this in prosa, and I make the rhymes. So we did it, and became overnight kind of not a kind, really pop stars. So yeah, they had a nationwide, a huge success. They played in stadiums and things like that. The songs, yeah, it was a ethno rock group, very influenced by Jethro Tull, yeah, and they had a chance because the Romanian folklore is very rich, so, and they did a good music, but hard ethno rock, so, and. We wrote a kind of archaic text, a kind of very almost hermetic poetry. And when I was going with my poet, my friend, to the concert, he was completely dispelled because you couldn't hear a word. We did five texts for this album. Two of them became huge hits, and one of them is a ballad, so you can hear the words. It was a gypsy song, one year later, when the tour was finished, they asked me if we don't want to write the lyrics for the. They had a proposition to make a double album, and I told him I can't go to Sherban, my friend, to say we are not text writers and so. He was quite smart. I did, no. We want an opera, rock opera. It was the time when Tommy came out from The Who and the Wall from Pink Floyd, etc. And it was the period with rock operas. And I thought, oh, this is different. I can tell Sherban we have to write a libretto. This sounds better for him. And so we did it. And this double album was called Canta Fabule, and it's a bestiarium. It's a, yeah, we did, from the first idea, not very original, because they was called Phoenix, and we think, okay, we did a bestiarium with fantastic animals like unicorn, siren, etc., and on the end is an anthem for Phoenix. Yeah, it's a good album. Yeah. So, what I want to say with this, it was in my youth, from my youth, a kind of fusion between an understanding of art and culture, of a fusion between old high culture and pop, yeah. So this is something that I follow my entire life. And then in the spring of 81, I quit Romania for West Germany. I had the feeling that the next years will be really bad there, and it was so. The 80s was a night; they were a nightmare there. And so I had our son was very, very little, 4 months old when I quit the country. And my wife and my son, they come after 20 months. We were separated almost 2 years. So, and when I arrived in Germany, I understood that it's over with literature. I was not a very productive writer. I wrote, I don't know, one, two short stories in a year, so it's not a huge volume. And I understood that with literature is, to the end, I don't want to become a kind of exile writer, to live in another culture and to write in, I don't know, in a, from their perspective in a small language and so. And then I was obliged to, I don't know, to come for my family with a subsistence thing. And I had a chance to get a job at a university in Heidelberg first, and then in Mannheim, it's near to Heidelberg, on a chair of Italian and French literature, but it was a chair, romance languages, yeah, and but it was a chair with focus on theory. So and they did literature theory, and it was on the middle of the 80s when the in German so-called Medienwissenschaft, how it's in this communication, no? How it's in English, Medienwissenschaft, Mediologie in French. Media studies, yeah, media studies. So, media studies. They were founded in Europe in France by philosophers and sociologists like Baudrillard and Virilio, and in Germany it was founded by philologues like we. So and. They were looking for somebody who has a link between literature, theory, literature, cinema, literature, and so I get a job then as assistant, and I teach literature and cinema, and and I was at the beginning okay, and then not very happy. I find it's a kind of double exile in to be in the secondary discourse. I don't know, and in a way, in other way, it was a very important experience to get a serious theoretical basis and found for my work, and when in 90. In 89, in winter, fall of the Berlin Wall, and then the events in Bucharest with this first tele-revolution, television, who took place in the television studio, and so I was naturally very moved and emotionally special state of I was going back to Romania early and after the events in already to beginning of January 90 with my old buddies from the pop band. We organized a kind of help convoy for the people there, so and then I decided I made a book, a theory, media studies book called Television Revolution: The Ultimatum of the Images, together with a colleague of the faculty in Mannheim who was specialized in photography, and the first half of the book, in the first half of the book there. Four long dialogues with friends of mine Romanian intellectuals, two of Timișoara, from Timișoara and two from Bucharest, who witnesses these events, two of them as eyewitness because they were going on the streets and the others on the television, like we in Occident also. So, and Farocchi found this book in, by friends in Vienna. He has also a kind of personal crisis because he was not capable to do something about the end of the fall of the Berlin Wall, and he was thinking maybe with this distance to make it about other events far east, more east, yeah, a good man. And he contacted me through the publishing house, and was surprised to meet somebody who is so near to the cinema. He expected to find only a kind of theoretical academic or something. And his idea was to do something that we have done after the film for television, a kind of, I don't know, like a seminar to take some images from this television transmission in Romania, who was broadcasted worldwide then, and with a group of four people, two of, from my book, and two German theorists to discuss and analyze these images. And I told her, I'm not very interested to repeat the book, and I'm also not very interested to make a seminar in. I do it every week. So and but I propose it, let us do a film about the things that they are not in the book. It means about the videograms of this of these events, and so so started our project. So and so it was my way back to the primary discourse. So I find my way in the in the cinema in which I had not the language problems like in literature. And this kind of I don't know international accent it's still here because my first film with Farocchi the text it's a essay film, the original text is in German. I wrote it in German. My second film, I made it in Russia. It is in Russian. The third of this trilogy, I go back to Romania and did the film about Ceausescu is in Romanian. And the new one on which I work now is in English because it's a New York story. Yeah, so. In the era, yeah, Romania has in cinema not a really important tradition. Not to compare with the Soviet Union or also Hungary or Poland or the Czech the Czechoslovakia. Culturally speaking, Romanian was a very literature-centered country. Yeah, it's a Romance language. It's an island in a Slavic ocean, and so, and that's why the influence. To the French culture and to Paris, and so it was very strong. So, in another way, surprisingly, a part of the Romanian literature has an important contribution to the classical avant-garde. Yeah, because Tristan Zarahu is the founder of the Dadaist, a Romanian Jew who emigrated to Zurich for not to go to the war together with Brauner and Marcel Iancu and so. And then Brâncuș with the sculpture. So the Romanian culture gave a massive apport to the classical avant-garde, but it still remains very literature centered. Yeah. We had before the Second World War one or two promising directors who work in the style of the of the, of the of the of the period with some acceptable comedies, not somebody of the statue as you have. How is the name? Gavaldon? No. Not at this caliber, but interesting. Jean Georgescu is there. Okay, but in the so in the same period, as you know, Hollywood imported almost each European talent. So it was the time when in the 30s when this great emigration from Europe in the first time Jewish artists were going from Central and Eastern Europe to Hollywood, and the classical Hollywood is made by more than 70% from these people who was coming from the Ukraine, from Romania and Hungary. So I don't know. It's a long list. Edward G. Robinson, the classical gangster guy in the old movies, is from Bucharest. Lorin Bacal, the famous Lorin Bacal, the wife of Humphrey Bogart, is from Bacău in Romania, in eastern Romania. Paul Newman is from Budapest. Harvey Keitel is from parents is from Romania, and so on. And Michael Curtis is Hungarian, and so on. Yeah, so so that in the 30s, it was not a natural developing of a national cinematography, but because the most important talents emigrated to Hollywood. So in the Soviet bloc time after the World War. In the 50s, there were few films. Under Ceausescu, he was interested in create a kind of national historical epos. So, and give money for the movies, and he had a director who could do this for him. The name is Sergiu Nicolaescu. He died a few years ago. Who was a kind of
the official?
Yeah, but his talent was a kind of I don't know. Also in for foreigners, a kind of solid B movie director. So in a way in which. There are some Italian directors who were doing films, Sender films with Romans and things like that. So, and he does this kind of historical movies with much of money and army and thousands of people and things like that. In fact, the first important Romanian auteur film, he came only in 68 or with Lucian Pintilie's film called Reconstituirea, who is a kind of is the founder of the auteur filmmaking in Romania. And then in the 70s there was two guys, Pizza and Veroiu, who did always one, two films, and then they were censored and blocked, and Veroiu emigrated to France, Pizza stayed there, and in the 80s it was another one called Tatos, who and Daniel Luc too, who managed to make three, four films. This is very, very little, very few in comparison with what in the same time was going on in Poland, for example, or in Czechoslovakia or so. So.
In that sense, this other East Europe countries have a very interesting tradition in the film to the children, to the educational, or maybe a civic culture for the children. What happened with the aim of the new Ceausescu regime about the need to make a new, to shape a new generation of citizens?
For this they did a lot of propaganda, like everywhere in Eastern Bloc. I'm not so sure that the Polish or Czechoslovak or Hungarian avant-garde film had an influence on the children, because these films were quite difficult. So, and as anywhere. In the world, the children, with exception of the Soviet Union, but in all other countries, you must know that Disney was not forbidden. So that the biggest influence on the new generation there is was always there the Disney films, and not
another.
With exception of the Czechoslovakia, they have a big tradition in animation. In the other Eastern country, not so much. It is true that these Czech films they were exported and for the entire Ostblock to have not only Disney, to have also, I don't know, socialist animation or so. But in Romania, for example, the animation was underdeveloped, till today, yeah. Yeah, it's exactly what I think. My fascination for this specific revolution, it was also because It's very, from a dramaturgical point of view, it's accomplished. You have the entire scenario, yeah, from the people who can come over the fear barrier and go to the streets, and then come all these pathetic moments, and the power is beginning to shaking and then to broke down, till really to the end with the execution of the king or of the dictator. Yeah, it's a complete complete scenario. So, if you want, like in the French one and in the October Revolution, and the new aspect here is that we get a new historical place with the same importance as the classical historical place. The classical historical place for a revolution is to occupy the piazza, the place in front of the power, yeah, to go to Bastille or to, in this case, they occupied the piazza, the place before the Central Committee, and they make an assault as the assault on the Winter Palace in Dix and occupy the building. And the tyrant is going away, and then he's captured and killed. So, but in this scenario, we have for the first time the apparition of the other historical place with the same importance, and it means to occupy the public image. The public image is coming from the television. We are speaking from a period before the internet and before the multi-channel television in all this country. You have one national television with two programs, and that's all. If you occupied this, you occupied the public image. So, and this was the new aspect here. But on the other side, because you asked me, I discovered in the narration, in the narrative of this scenario here, the general rules of a revolutionary narratives. Yeah, it starts heroic with the people in front of the power, risking their lives with a power who tried to stop this and killed some of the demonstrants and so. Then the power is it's shaking and destabilized. More and more people come. They occupied the power places, in this case two, from the historical place in the city, the piazza from Central Committee, and then the public image, and then the next two acts of each revolutionary scenario, they are different. The pathetic decline to Kitsch, and the end is a kind of moral comedy, yeah, in which the people try to find their new roles in a fictive or virtual new world, yeah. A new period.
Yeah. I don't know if you went back to Romania, and how does your vision of the revolution change when you get back to Romania after the revolution?
No, I when I started to make the film that I want to make the movie, it was the my primary impulse. That's why I told Farocchi also, let's do the film of these things, of these events. It was to try to reconstruct, first of all, for me, for myself, the film of these days. Also because I was obsessed with the idea, and I felt also guilty that I was not there, and I could not go also on the streets and take part on these events. So, and the film is like this from the minute, I don't know, 20 or 16, when the last discourse of Ceausescu is over, and this kind of analysis of pictures that we did on the beginning comes to the end. Then the entire rest of the film, it's nothing else that an approach to reconstruct the film of this events minute by minute. So you have no more real information when you come. It's also for the historians. So when you come after some events and you talk with people, because the subjectivity and the coefficient of fantasy in the human memory, it's so enormous that you never get a real picture of some events if you talk with eyewitnesses after that. That's also the reason why very big part of the historiography of our perception of history, it's a kind of half fiction. Yeah.
Thank you. But this is a very, very strong interpretative view of the history. Because all your films, as same the Farocchi's, are another point of view of the central part of the broadcast to make a testimony, a documentary, but not ever is truth. It's always, it's certainly as a truth, but my question is how do you understand in began the understanding of that kind of processes in the media, especially on TV, when at the beginning of the 80s in Germany, because you have access to another kind of images, maybe the Poland strikes with a Solidaridad,
yeah.
or maybe the question very important for that time, Perestroika, or maybe to have a personal sensation when the Chernobyl tragedy. How could you remember that process to understanding the make of the TV? It's capable to make a very wide processes to the societies.
Yeah. Till the end of the 80s, the images that we saw from the Solidarność, from the movement in Poland, or from Perestroika, from Chernobyl, we didn't have really images, very few or so. We had only this artistic interpretation of it, like in the last film of by Tarkovsky and so, who is a strange coincidence, because he did when the film was finished, the Chernobyl took place. So, in the my surprise began in 89, when all these movements started with Tiananmen in China, in Beijing, and then in autumn with from Budapest with the Germans, they were in the German embassy in Budapest, and then the images from Prague with this Velvet Revolution. You could observe that with the new mobility of the VHS cameras, they were coming out at the time. You have not another kind of images, but the duration is different. This camera could record more than some news clips or so. And the shock was then, no, generally, when you saw the images of the of these Romanian events, because they occupied the studio, TV studio, and it was a broadcast, a continuous broadcasting for 72 hours. No, it's 3 days and three nights. No, so and then. When we came to Bucharest and started the research and discovered, I was very surprised that there were much more cameras who recorded this amateur cameras that I expected in a country who was so much under control. On the end, they are. I don't know, they are on the credits of the film, that they are around 150 cameras. Yeah? It was in a city in which each typewriter machine must be recorded. So, and okay, with the discovering of this, in fact, new kind of historical documents, historical visual documents, I started to reflect about new possibilities to understanding history and to make a new kind of historiography, because the conclusion are quite simple. I understood step by step that which is not visible when you are only in the school, understood step by step that all this what we called history or historiography, it's in a very high percentage propaganda. Yeah, the chronists were employers of the power to write about events from the perspective of their commissioners. Then the classical chronicles also. Then with the coming of the so-called new historiography after the French Revolution. They came in the same time with the building of national states. So each historiography in each state has his perspective. A classical example is Napoleon. Napoleon, it's completely different in a French school book from a German school book, from a Russian school or from a Polish school book. And it's for... it's for every event. So that means that our perception of history it's completely influenced by the great coefficient of historical propaganda. So, and that's why this is also because what I say a little bit earlier, it exists nothing more questionable eyewitness report. That's why also the trials in a murder trials or things, they are so difficult, because the judge, he has to try to find the truth from a complex of subjective reports and lies. No, so and the historical eyewitness are in the same situation. They tell all the time a story in their which is in their opinion the right one. So the paper documents that were there also in a huge percent interpretative, like statistics. You can with the same documents argument for many things. So, and I understood that with this new kind of historical document, who is the recorded moving images of historical events, and first of all, with a new possibility in duration given by the video, you have access to something which gives you a new element. In the moving images, they are preserved or conserved fragments of time. In the moving images, you have access also to the psychology of the actors, like in a movie, because you can read it in the mimic, in the face, in the gesture. You can understand when the guy is lying or not lying, or so. You have access to the a direct access to the psychology of the history, and this is a new dimension. If you have only a written a document or a eye testimony, this is not the case. We have now the possibility in looking and analyzing this new kind of historical documents to have a larger view or interpretation possibilities to interpret the history. So yeah, and it exists. A very precise date in which this process began, and this is the D-Day when the ally comes to Normandy, and together with a photographic unit led by John Ford and George Stevens, with around 420 cameramen from many nationalities, American, English, Belgian, I don't know. Many of them died. But from the D-Day on, in fact, what the historian didn't understood till recently, from this moment we can reconstruct each important historical or social event of the second half of the 20 histories only with original preserved fragments of time.
Do you think Romanian films were do you feel that Romanian films were censored or banned not only before but after the Ceausescu era?
Sorry,
Do you think that the Romanian films were censored before, or not only before, after the Romanian the Ceausescu era?
That the Romanian film after the Ceausescu
Were censored, were banned. Because in Mexico we know the Yugoslavian films, post Yugoslavia era, like Kusturica, like Manchevsky.
Yeah.
But we don't know much about Romanian films.
Yeah. But you heard about this movement, is now 15 years old, called the New Romanian Cinema or New Romanian Wave, no?
Yeah.
Yeah. I have a theory about this. Not everybody in agree with it, but I think that this New Romanian Cinema comes out, and it was possible because they had a double hour zero. Yeah, it's the New Romanian Cinema, this way for 15 years, it's a kind of neo-neorealism. It's given by historical conditions. The situation in Romania after 89, it was quite similar with the situation in Italy after the Second World War, also with the trauma of a clownesque dictator and tyrant, Mussolini there, Ceausescu here. So, and in these periods, historical periods, and certain places, it's an enormous pressure of the reality through the arts. The stories are everywhere on the ground. You can only to get down and put one of them, get one of them. So, and normally this pressure, it's against, toward the narrative arts. Literature or film can react to this. So in the 19th century, it was the literature and the great historical roman, a novel of the period, and after the Second World War, it was the cinema who took this. We have this huge example with a great Italian neorealist. On another scale, on a smaller scale, the same thing was going on in Romania after the end of the Ceausescu era. And my thesis is that they had the chance here to have a double hour zero, in contrast to the Poland, Hungarian, Russia, Czechoslovakia, where the young filmmakers were completely, I don't know, under the pressure of their own filmic historical tradition. Yeah, they were completely, I don't know, under the pressure of Tarkovsky and of Vaida, and of this. This pressure didn't exist in Romania, because they had not the burden of a great cinematic tradition, and that's why a group of young filmmakers, all also with the element that with this rare, were all also quite good writers. They have to choose to write these things or to make films. It was for their generation, for the period, it was more normal to try to make films. That is, in my opinion, the explanation why this phenomenon and why this new neo-neorealism, it came out in Romania and not in the other of the East European countries with much more cinematic tradition.
How did you decide to make the autobiography of Nicola Ceausescu? Was this related to Videograms of a Revolution, or
was that was what?
Like, how did you decide?
Yeah, that's the last.
Is it somehow related to Videograms of a Revolution, like creatively or methodologically?
With Ceausescu, it was like this. When I, with a great delay, the Romanian television decided to broadcast Videograms in 2005, 13 years after the film was made, and so I was invited to Bucharest for this. And what did a national television when they have they feel them guilty? So they give you the best place. It was prime time, Saturday evening at 8 o'clock, and. After the movie with a discussion in a panel in studio, and for this I was invited. And when I was there in 2005, a lady who worked for us as a researcher coordinator for Videograms in 91, in the meantime she became a producer, a good producer in Romania. She saw me in the television, and then she called me, and we met each other. And she asked me if I don't think that now it's the time arrived, and we have the distance to make a biography of Ceausescu in a way or with this kind of objectivity. We have to do this with Videograms for this revolution. And I told her yes. In principle, you're right, but this is a subject, a proposal for a subject, but it's not already an idea. I must to find an cinematic and filmic a cinematic idea to make a film about this. I don't make TV documentaries or things like that to tell something about his life. So, and then I was going back to Germany, and I don't know if it was for my birthday, which is in autumn in November, or for the Christmas, but my best friend in Germany, who is a known philosopher, Peter Sloterdijk, he gave me as gift because she knew I was fascinated. I have a fascination of Cuba. He gave me a book called. The autobiography of Fidel Castro, written by a Cuban exile writer. So, and that was the click, and so I did. This is the way. I could make not a biography of Ceausescu, but I could make his autobiography working only with the images he commanded, yeah, so.
Thank you so much. This is a very compelling discussion. I was wondering if you could talk in more general terms about your methodology. You've already done this a lot, and it's been really rich, but especially about how you go about choosing and also defining the scope of the archive that you work with for a particular film. And then also, perhaps a related question, how you structure the narrative that will become ultimately the film in what you, I think, what you call this medium of primary discourse.
Primary what?
The primary discourse, which I think was your word for coming back to these original documents of the film.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. How to say it? Uh, in a classical perception, primary discourse is something approach to the create what today is a stupid known creative writing. No, so the writer of the poet or the writer of the novels and stories and so. He create a so-called primary discourse. So, in the and then we have the essay, which is something between fictional literature and interpretation of a more theoretical or reflectional interpretation of reality, and the essay is also primary a primary discourse. Secondary discourse is it's used normally for the exegesis. No, it's the academic literature about existing works. Yeah, or a part of the historiography is also secondary discourse. So, and when I wrote literature in my youth, I had a. Evolution from this Cortázar influenced phase, in which I wrote a number of short stories, and one of them is my preferred till today, and I use it in my new film project. So, but then I made an evolution, who finally ended in the blockade in the block. I could no more writing, and this last phase in my writing, it was something very experimental. I tried to. To play with the language on many levels, in a way to try to make a kind of to transpose the Joycean literary experience in other language. It didn't work so easy, and not with 22 or 24 or things like that. So that I had a strong blockade. So, and then with the exile, this was more stronger because I tell you, I don't want to be an exile writer in a small language. I don't know, I was always fascinated by cinema. My fascination to cinema is equal so only for literature. But I didn't do anything in my youth to come to the cinema. I had so kind of phantasma that one day it will happen, and it was like this. So, and. When this historical events started there, and with this enormous emotion of the period, and all these coincidences and chances with Farocchi coming and asking and so, I find to this way, and in my own interpretation, I see no difference. It's a prolongation exactly of my the things that I do on the paper on literature, the same thing I do it on film. In the last phase of my writings, my interest was my focus was to experiment on the border between genres and to try to find or to invent new genres. Yeah. And that's exactly what I do in the in the movies, using existing material which is not shot for me. And when I make a completely new edit of this material and I changed his senses, this is in a deep way, it's essayistic work. I reinterpret existing things, and I reflect through this. And then, but when you construct a new narrative for all this, from a certain point, it becomes your story, and it's like written by yourself.
Yeah. It's me again. Can you share us your cinematographic influences?
My cinematographic influences. First of all, discovered very late, it's Esfir Shub, who is the woman who founded the montage film. It's an early Soviet filmmaker. She was the assistant and then the editor for Jiga Vertov, and also for the early Eisenstein films. And in 1927, when in Moscow they prepared for the first 10 years anniversary of the revolution, they had not enough money to make a new film about this. Okay, the project was financed in the work, but not finished. It's October by Eisenstein. And in this, it was a desperate situation. They need to have something. And then Esfir Shub come with a proposal. She can do it only using archival images. And she did a film called, you can find it on YouTube, but in a extreme bad quality, called the Decline of the Romanov Dynasty. So, and this is the really beginning of what we call today montage film or compilation film or footage film. All these names are not proper, but it's like this, yeah. And then influences from the history of cinema. I have a great great admirer of Tarkovsky's work. Almost all films, but they have not a direct influence on me. Maybe something in Out of the Present. I'm a huge Kubrick fan, as a lot of people. I admire enormously Bresson, but like someone who is on a complete different planet or so. I'm a Dreyer fan. I know Pelishan very well. We met in Moscow when I worked to Out of the Present. We became friends, which is not so easy with him. He's a really difficult guy. I admire enormously some of his films, the Seasons. It's really an unbelievable masterpiece. And Our Century, his archive with the flying, and so which I was completely shocked when I saw it. I don't know. I reviewed it some months ago, so it loses a little bit from
is
the.
Is it the management of time?
In his case, yeah, he invented a so-called method called distance editing or montage. So he tried to, when he wrote a text, a kind of theory or this. I don't believe a word of this. The truth that this power comes from instinct and talent. He didn't know really what it is, but he tried to explain it in a theory. I don't think that you can repeat it. You can read this text, and he makes some schema. If you try to make the same, it's nothing. It's his enormous talent.
Can you?
But he has a kind of strange leitmotifs or a distance rhythmization. You know the text. You can find it. It's called the distance montage.
Can you speak to us about your relation with Paul Virilio and your collaboration with him?
Yeah, Virilio, he discovered videograms of a revolution. I forget how. Yeah, but it was on the beginning. I know because Virilio. I invited him in the last part of this book, what I made, this television revolution. And the last part, it was four or five articles by philosophers and sociologists. And one of the it was one text of Virilio, one text from Baudrillard, and two texts from German scientists. And so we come in contact with this book. And then he asked me what I'd do the next, and I told him about the film, and he was interested to see the film when it's finished. And I sent him the film, and then he did something very important for the history of this film, of the life of this film, that he talked with Baudrillard, and they organized, and it was already in 92 when the film was very, very fresh. So in the Collège International de Philosophie in Paris, they organized a colloquium around the movie with him and Baudrillard and Jacques Poulin, who was the president of the college, and so the entire Parisian intelligentsia was there, and so it was the start of the film in the academic circles. So, and then we remain in a very good relation till his death. He was also, because when I finished out of the present, he was a huge admirer and fan of the film. Much of all what is in this film, it has a intimate correspondence with things of his own thinking and feeling. Unknown Quantity. It was it's a commissioned work, one of two I have in my life, because the Cartier Foundation in Paris, who discovered Out of the Present on the end of the 90s, and they organized an entire exhibition around the film. It was not so usual on that time to make exhibition about a film. Today it's around the film. Today it's common that the film is very present in exhibition. And for the catalog of this exhibition was called Edmond Réal, the director of the Cartier Foundation asked me to make two long conversations, one with Krikalev, with the cosmonaut of the movies. For that we were going to Moscow, and one with Virilio. So And that was 1999. And in 2002, 3 years later, Cartier organized a Virilio exhibition with the title Seki Arif, about the idea of the history as the accident in the history and the historical catastrophes. And the English title of this exhibition was unknown, a quantity, and they asked me if I don't want to make something with Virilio and Svetlana Alexievich, but they discovered her book about Chernobyl. So, and it was 10 years before she won the Nobel Prize, no? And yeah, and then I accepted, and then the tours were coming to Karlsruhe, where I was already. I had my professorship there in the school near to ZKM, and we did this. But it was a commissioned work for this exhibition. Yeah.
I'm curious if you could talk a little bit more about the right distance of time or the cycle of time in which one can discover the narrative or really see history in perspective. And each generation, I imagine, brings their own perspective and recreates it once it's made. But what is the appropriate time?
I think in the middle film of this trilogy, in Out of the Present, the main subject of the film is the time question, of the difference level of the time, the time on Earth, the historical time, the political time, and then the astral time in cosmos or so, I told yesterday in the we have a very good Q&A after the screening of Out of the Present. I thought the title of the film Out of the Present is in fact a paraphrase from Out of the Past. It's a famous noir film made by Jacques Tourneur in Hollywood soon after the Second World War, and the title was a metaphor and a statement: "Let's get out of this past and build a new present." Yeah, and for me, that's why I gave the title Out of the of the Present, because with the end of the Soviet Union, for a short time we have a time receipt, so and we get out of this present, and after this receipt we had the chance to start a new present time. And for a short time it was a hope of this. Sadly, this is not happened. So, in the intellectual discourse, the intellectual discourse after a short time of silence, they try to continue to talk as in the old present of the 20th century, always with this paradigm, left, right, and things like that, who, in my opinion, didn't work anymore. And that's why my conviction is that the intellectual discourse today is so irrelevant. Yeah.
You have been a very important witness of generational change of media technology. When you was a child, the radio broadcast, it was the main. In writing, as a literature, it was the main. After that, you discover cinema, and after the TV broadcast, and after another and another, after internet, and now. But how do you think the radio broadcast is as a discourse of the sound is the principal way to reach the deep side of the humankind?
Yeah, it's an important question, but it's not so easy to to answer. I think that we are now in a very complicated period or a phase, very complex in our relationship with the representations of reality. So we have till the end of the 20th century, in acceleration of industrial progress, in two centuries, with the apparition of the photography, which is the a very realistic representation of a frozen moment, and then for the first time with another kind of visual document. And then what I saw with the invention of the film camera, we had for the first time the possibility to have at our disposal preserved, conserved fragments of time. Yeah. Which is new. Yeah. On all these movies, on we have preserved for ages. I don't know. So many people in so different different ages. So we have preserved forever the young Marilyn Monroe, the young Alain Delon, the young Clark Gable, then all this Kennedy, etc., etc. Ourselves also, the new generation, they grow up all with home movies and home videos and all this. So, in the first last quarter of the century, you could follow this on the developing of the evolution of the Hollywood. Yeah. At a certain point, starting with the Star Wars, in fact, the film left this path to represent a reality, and took another approach to construct other universes, so that the mainstream film today, it's in a first time concerned to create this new universes, the Marvel universe, the things, the DC universe, and all this, and representation of reality became for the very new generation, in a way, boring. That's also why everybody can do this. In fact, with a smartphone, each person is social media, each person is a individual TV channel. He can articulate, he can make reportage, he can make transmission, he can make all. So that also the power of central medias, not only print medias, also for, of television, it's in a big decline. So, and the entire problem of the fake news and the manipulations of the media, they are now so present. It's an interesting moment, but it's a moment in this relation to representation of reality. It's a moment of great confusion. Yeah.
What do you think is the use of documentary or like reality-based films in the era of like smartphones, post-truth, deepfakes, and all that stuff?
Yeah, I. What to say? It remains a question of talent and inspiration. I read a few days ago on the net a dialogue between Scorsese and Tarantino, and Scorsese tells at one moment when in the 60s and second half of the 60s, he and his friends in New York, they were film students and going to the cinema, when they saw for the first time Shadows by Cassavetes, they told his friends, Scorsese, from now on we have no excuse. When Cassavetes takes a small camera and go to the streets and is capable to make a great film, we cannot stay and say, oh, we have no money and no production of this, we can do it. Today is the same thing with, theoretically, each one can make a good movie with his iPhone. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.